Well, I won't deny that I had wished that if my talk was one talk before, because after such an inspiring and passionate talk, my talk is going to appear very bland to most of you, because it's going to take you back to our mundane clinical stuff. So I'm going to talk over the next 15 minutes on some of the principles of continuous glucose monitoring, compare a few of the currently available devices, interpret the ambulatory, since it's a workshop also, so see a few tips of interpreting an ambulatory glucose profile, and if time permits, we'll go through a case. So a post-DCCT, HbA1c and SMBG are the standard of care with respect to the current type 1 diabetes. And while we are struggling even to get this done, now we are being told that these are not enough. So we understand that these parameters do have limitations, such as HbA1c does not tell us day-to-day variations, which is an important factor in determining outcomes. It can also be affected by hypoglycemia. It can be affected by hemoglobinopathies and iron deficiency and some other conditions. We know that people with similar HbA1cs can have really different glycemic profile. On the other hand, self-monitoring of blood glucose, while being extremely important, we know that is not done often. If whatever amount of time it is done, it is not written often. If it is written, it is written invariably incompletely without the information that we would desire, and sometimes even incorrectly. When we see such a log, there is a natural tendency to look at the abnormal values, which may actually be forming a very small portion of the total values, but we tend to focus on highs and lows. And it does not indicate whether at that particular time whether the glucose was declining or whether it was going up. So that may lead to incorrect treatment of hypo or hyperglycemia. So this does tell us that it is important to have additional tools in seeing what is happening to the glucose trends. And therefore, continuous glucose monitoring, which monitors the interstitial glucose. So the difference from the glucometers is that it is monitoring interstitial glucose, not the capillary glucose. So the first device was introduced in 1999, which used to look somewhat like this, which had a sensor, had a cable, and a recorder or receiver. From then, we have come a long way, with the current devices being very compact and ability to have transmission to either a nice recorder or even smartphones. So the technology has come a long way in this. As I said, that we are measuring interstitial glucose. Most of the meters have three parts. One is a sensor, which is nothing but an electrode, which is there in the subcutaneous area, monitoring the glucose, a transmitter, and a recorder or receiver, which in some of the pumps is just the smartphone. It uses glucose oxidase technology, just as in glucometers, for detection of interstitial glucose, where the glucose is interacting with oxygen in the presence of glucose oxidase enzyme, forming hydrogen peroxide, and subsequently releasing electrons, which are converted into a signal and is compared to the capillary glucose as a reference base. Since it is in the interstitial compartment, it invariably lags behind the capillary glucose values, and the values may be somewhat different. And therefore, we need calibration. And also, we just don't need calibration in the beginning. We need it periodically, because there is what is called a sensor drift, which means that over a period of time, there can be a gap between what the sensor measures and what the actual capillary glucose are. And therefore, we need recalibration also. Now, calibration for the currently available iPro and Dexcom meters is at least required twice a day, and is best done when the sugars are relatively stable, not when they're going up or down. Now, the Flash Libre or Libre Pro, which has become immensely popular, is factory calibrated, and it does not need a patient to do calibrations. It also uses a wired enzyme technology, which minimizes the sensor drift, and therefore we don't need repeated calibrations over a period of the 2 weeks that it uses. There are two types of CGM, as most of us would know, a professional and real-time CGM. Most of the settings in India use a professional CGM largely, where patient is blinded to the data during the period of recording, and the data is downloaded, analyzed afterwards. So while the sensing is happening, the patient is not able to see the data. And such a CGM is extremely useful to diagnose what is the disparity between HbA1c and the blood glucose values, or detect hypoglycemia, or understand reasons for abnormal patterns. On the other hand, real-time CGM has real-time access for the patient either on a receiver or on a smartphone, which can show trends in glucose. So the patient can see if the glucose is going down or up. There will be a facility for alarms for hyper and hypoglycemia so that the patient can act on what is happening. And this is used by patients for treatment of low and high glucose. There's no absolute compartmentalization. So these real-time glucometers sensors can also be downloaded for a periodic time. And as we know that if we have the reader of the Flash Libre, it can also be intermittently scanned to see the glucose readings at that in the point of time. So currently we have Medtronic iPro 2, Libre Pro, Dexcom G4. We don't have the G5 and G6, and Medtronic Guardian Connect devices available for us, our patients in India. I hope that we would also soon get devices like this, where this is an implantable Eversense device, which is able to record, which is implanted subcutaneously in OPD, and is able to record the readings for 90 or 180 days. So the currently, this is a table comparing the currently available CGM devices, and you can see that Libre scores well with regards to the most important aspect, that is cost. It is able to record readings over a period of 14 days, although in terms of accuracy, especially in terms of the lower readings, it scores a bit less as compared to the other meters, which is Medtronic Guardian and Dexcom G6. These two real-time monitors are also have a facility of remote monitoring on smartphone. So the parent can see what the glucose values are when the child is not near them also. So is CGM useful? Rakesh has shared some of the data in his presentation. So there are plenty of studies which show that continuous glucose monitoring is useful. This is one such study. For those in PET school, they've seen this article by Professor Battalino. And this was a study where there was a randomized crossover of patients off and on the real-time continuous glucose monitor. And you can see in this lower graph that when they were on the CGM, when they were using the real-time CGM, there was a steady decline of the HbA1c, and when they were put off the CGM, the values of HbA1c climbed up to the nearly baseline value. So yes, real-time CGM does help, but it does require continued adherence and continued use. So a patient has to be using it on ongoing basis. It is not just you put it for 7 days and 10 days and you will be able to have good glycemic control or reduction of hypoglycemia. In the same study, there was also reduced time spent in hypoglycemia while the patients were using the real-time sensor. Not just patients on pump. The data from Type 1 Diabetes Exchange also shows that those who are using MDI also get benefit. So these are the black bars of patients who are using MDI and CGM. So CGM is useful even for our patients who are using basal bolus regimen, and it makes a case for us to increase use of this technology. Most of us do a single CGM or single flash glucose monitoring. So we tried to see whether this was useful in our patients. We did about consecutive 51 patients. We did a flash glucose monitoring for 14 days. In most of the patients, it was able to record readings for up to 10 days or more. So it indicates feasibility of doing it. And the most important finding was the amount of nocturnal hypoglycemia that we have in our patients, which is practically, patients never do SMBG in the night. So therefore, many patients had nocturnal hypoglycemia in this particular study with a median of 3 nights of in those 10 or 14 days that they were recording. The single professional CGM also led to improvement in the testing behavior. When we counseled the patients and told that this is the kind of variation that you're getting, we were able to have a monitoring frequency increased from baseline of 45 to nearly 65%. However, obviously, a single CGM cannot change the HbA1c, so we did not have any difference in the pre and post HbA1c. Now, coming to the interpretation part of the glucose profile, for those, most of you would be aware of this international consensus on use of continuous glucose monitoring, which is a very good document since it brings some uniformity between the devices in terms of reporting of the CGM downloads. So this consensus statement recommends using ambulatory glucose profile as a standard of visualization of CGM data. So AGP is not unique only to Libre. AGP is just a output of the continuous glucose monitoring. It can be done on any of the meter. And recommends minimum of 14 days and approximately 70% of possible CGM readings to enable optimum analysis to make changes which could be impacting subsequent 60 or 90 days. It also advises on 14 key metrics to assess glycemic control, changing the focus just from HbA1c or single blood glucose value to factors like time in range, time that you spend in level 1 or level 2 hypo or hyperglycemia, and the amount of instability or variability that we see in the glucose profile. So what exactly is ambulatory glucose profile? We are used to these worms or spaghetti kind of lines, which sometimes are very confusing if the patient has extreme variability in diet, and we just sometimes I feel giddy while I see those lines. So what AGP does is it constructs a modal day plot which collapses this data into curves akin to our growth charts that we see. So it gives us as if these events happened over 24 hours. So this is the lower panel is the AGP output. It has 5 set of curves. So the dark blue line that you see is the median of those values. The dark blue shaded area is the 25th and 50th centile, so 50% of the values, and the light blue shaded area is the 10th and 90th centile. So what AGP does is it focuses the focus of management is 80% of the readings, which in a SMBG log could be the extreme 10 or 20% of the readings. To make sensible interpretation of the AGP, we also need what happened each and every day. So we need input from the daily glucose summaries. So AGP and daily glucose summaries, along with relevant history, can help us to determine the cause of abnormal patterns. Some of the key terminologies used in interpretation of ABG are glucose exposure or glycemic exposure, which is indicated by area under curve of the median line. Glucose variability, which is indicated by the spread of readings around that median, which is the interquartile and interdecile range. Glucose stability, which means how stable the median line is over a period of time. So this is positive instability when it is climbing upwards, and this is negative instability when it is coming downwards. Positive doesn't mean nice here. Positive just means that the readings are going upwards. And hypoglycemia risk, which is a composite derivative of actual glucose values, variability, and negative instability. So you may not actually have the values going below 70, but somebody, if he has huge variability or negative instability, they are at more risk of hypoglycemia. How do we interpret? First thing that we do is identify patients correctly, because as we get busier, we might get multiple sensors being couriered to us from different places, and we need to have the unique number that is recorded on the patient while the sensor is being installed. We have to see whether the recording refers to the dates where we intend to do the analysis, and we have to have history. Without history, we cannot interpret. So we do provide them with a log where they maintain details of their diet activity, and this is helpful in determining. Without this complete information, it is often not pretty productive to have interpretation of the AGP. Then we divide the curve into as per the meal timings, as pre or post meal parts and overnight parts, or as per time slots, such as overnight, early part of the day, late evening, etc. Similar to how we interpret SMBG, we assess frequency of hypoglycemic events and hypoglycemia risk. We evaluate glycemic exposure and stability. We see the glucose variability. And we summarize findings as what is the main observation, what is the primary observation, because that should be our main focus, and what is the secondary observation. And explore the behavioral causes underlying or which are responsible for these patterns, and then make therapeutic decisions. So let us go through a case to see how we go about. So this is a 13-year-old boy, which the AGP was done in 2017. He got diabetes 10 years back, and he also had celiac disease. Had extremely difficult family circumstances, the grandmother insisting on not giving insulin, and the mother had to hide somewhere and give insulin. So often she used to give sometimes one, sometimes two, sometimes three doses. Had short stature, delayed puberty, is on Lantus and regular insulin. So if we see his AGP, now this sort of, we are, I mean, this is the control that he had. Now what, how we go about interpreting is first we identify whether it is the same patient. Then we see the number of days. So it is data of 14 or 15 days, which is quite useful. Now another thing that one invariably does is you would just go by whatever lines are being shown. So the default range that comes out of the report is often not what we desire. So we have to edit that setting. So here the default range is shown as 80 to 160, but my goal is to maintain the readings between 70 to 180, which is the most common recommended goal as per the consensus statement and several other statements. So I have to have the appropriate range that I want to see. Then I mark the meal timings or the insulin timings that are happening. So here is the breakfast, lunch, and dinner timing. And what I see is that this child has high glycemic exposure. He has high variability. You can see the huge amount of spread. And he has huge instability. His instability is a very big problem here. And therefore, he also has high hypoglycemia risk. I would very much like to address I want to know why such instability is there. And therefore, I see daily curves. And what I see is that on many mornings, he gets up with low readings and then subsequently has very high readings after his breakfast. So we want to know what is happening, and therefore my educator helps me and by taking history, and she asks and finds out that he is taking insulin, only regular insulin, just 5 minutes before the meals. And this is one very common observation that I learned after doing the CGM studies, that people take their insulins just before the meal, or sometimes even during or after the meal. And at the time of low sugar, he simply skips the insulin, or he takes it after the meal. And obviously, he's fond of bhujia or chips, or he's doing all those things. But the key thing here is that the regular insulin is being taken just before the meal. And therefore, what is happening is that he's having high sugars after the meal, and which are subsequently dropping, because that is the time when regular insulin is acting. So therefore, a treatment decision for him would be to have optimum duration of insulin before he starts eating. If he gets some help or can afford the analogs, then switching over to analogs. So this is how AGP can help. So I would like to conclude by saying that CGM is indeed an important tool in diabetes management, and its use has to increase. We cannot give reasons for not using it or increasing its uses. Now, the currently available CGM technology does improve glycemic control, reduce hypoglycemia, and increase time in range, provided there is adherence to it and continued usage. This is very, very, very important factor. Standardized reporting format, as such as AGP, should be used, which gives useful insights into glucose pattern and abnormal glucose, the reasons behind those glucose patterns. Thank you so much for patience.